Keith Thurman, Tim Tszyu, what do you think? How do you break it down? How do you see it unfolding?
You know, what I like about this fight is that it's a real fight, you know? There's people who love my style, believe in my skills. I obviously believe in my skills signing this contract. But, you know, Tim Tszyu is young. Tim Tszyu is active. Tim Tszyu has been, you know, mostly fighting overseas, but he's been dominating in his division, moving up. You know, there's people who say, who is Tim Tszyu, this and that. You know, there's so much in boxing, you know, but sometimes, I mean, obviously he's world champion. He did something. He's done enough to be at the top. You're champion, you're at the top. You know, there's other champions. You know, the kid's only 24-0. You know, if I want to say, like, put something on it, he's only 24-0, you know. But, you know, that's what happens. You know, when you're 24-0, you become champion. That's great. That means you're doing good things. He's undefeated. He's got 17 knockouts, which means he's a puncher, but he's not 24-0 with 22 knockouts, right? So he's not, like, super deadly in that sense. That made me feel like, you know, I saw some of the tape, and I forget who it was, but I saw him taking damage. So if he was a puncher's puncher, the fight would have been over, you know, landing that many clean right hands, landing that many clean left hooks, even landing some uppercuts. Uppercut to the chinny chin chin, and the man was still standing up. So, you know, Tim Tszyu has power. I'm not going to say the boy does not have power. He has power. But the same, you know, you got to be there like Ali says. You got to hit me. You know, you got to be there. Your feet have to be planted. I got to be stagnant, and you got to hit me. I think that's the type of power that Tim Tszyu has. Maybe I'm wrong. March 30th, I'm willing to find out.
Keith, I feel like I've known you forever, and forever you've been at 47. Am I right?
Yeah.
It's about time to move up regardless. I think so. It's hard to stay one weight class. Coach K can tell you.
Nah, it's, you know, for my height and my body frame, you know, I do believe with the proper nutrition, you know, you got to remember, man, back in 2019 when I fought Manny Pacquiao, I mean, I literally left Tokyo 182 pounds. You know, I started my whole training camp. I probably left Tokyo 185. I started my training camp at 182, 11 weeks out from the agreed fight date. 11 weeks out, 35 pounds I had to lose, you know? And we made it happen. You know, that's 3.3, that's 3 pounds a week for 11 weeks. Plus a 2 pound water pool the day of the weigh-ins. You understand? So, you know, I don't know. I always have faith that I can make 147. I feel like a 147, but you know, boxing is boxing. Keith Thurman's not 25. Keith Thurman's 35. If there's any a time for me to test the waters, you know, I don't want to be that guy who moves up at 54 and, you know, everything's done in his career. You know, I'm, you know, 38 years old and I'm moving up to 54 for the first time and then just doing it to make some kind of fight, get a fight here or there. And, you know, it's different, you know. It was a little disappointing that I didn't qualify to compete for the world title. It doesn't change the purse. So at the end of the day, it's fine. I've already won 2 world titles. I established myself at 147. And come March 30th, when they raise my hand, the boxing world will know, on this date, Keith Thurman defeated the undefeated champion, you know? So I think it makes the fight really easy for him. It's a win-win. He, even with a loss, he doesn't lose anything but a little bit of pride, a little bit of reputation. But he's a young man. He can gain it all back with hard work and effort and dedication to the game, you know. And then obviously if he beats me, he gets a name that he doesn't have on his resume. So it's really a win-win for Tszyu. And then for myself, this is just the kind of fight that I like to bring to the fans. This is the kind of fight that is worthy of the kickoff of Amazon Prime pay-per-view. This is worthy of your money, you know? And I just didn't want to not make that happen. You know, I didn't want to have a fight that people would have been like, well, you know, that guy's ranked and it's okay. I didn't want an okay fight. I like great fights. We've had these talks before in the past, you know. Look at my resume. There's not a lot of fillers. There's not a lot of, he should just be fighting. He should just be doing this and that. I don't go to your job and tell you how to do your job, okay? Are you happy at your job? Okay, I don't just do this to provide for my family. I do this. I wear red, white, and blue every time I step in the ring because Keith Thurman is living a dream. I'm a dreamer, okay? Martin Luther King, I have a dream, and it's to put on some of the most exciting fights in one of the most exciting sports in all of sports. One of 3 minutes action, 1 minute interval of rest. This ain't no whistle-blowing football that all you Americans be watching anyways, all right? They don't even hit each other anymore. What are you watching? They don't even hit each other anymore.
NBA scores 150, 160, and everybody's scoring 70, what? 75. No defense, nothing.
Don't touch my cuticles. You touched my cuticles, okay?
But Keith, you don't believe in tune-ups. You don't believe in mismatches. You want to fight the best because you are the best. I got to ask you this. You never fought Crawford. You never fought Earl.
Yeah.
Would you like to fight them this year? Let's say you take care of business against...
This year, last year, and the year before, man. Right after Mario Barrios, I could have fought either one of them, you know? Long story short, we know Thurman was mandated by the WBC. What the heck was that meeting in Mexico all about? You know? What was that meeting all about, man? I don't know. You know what we say in the game. We call it politics. There is no president. There's no politicianers in boxing. Where are the politics? They're not politics. They're polytricks, okay? Poly meaning many, coming from the Greek Latin word meaning many, and tricks being all the crazy shit that we fighters and you fight fans have to deal with, okay? So it's polytricks, not politics, okay? Because ticks are blood-sucking parasites, if you don't know. So at the end of the day, man, it's don't hate the player. Don't hate the game. If you want it, just, you know, you got to stay true. What was that recent comment you just told me about today? About Devin Haney?
About what now?
Was it who said they're going to retire?
Oh, that was Stevenson.
Shakur Stevenson, man. Yeah. Shakur, man, calm down. Calm down, Shakur. The game's been messed up since before you were born, son. This game right here, what we do, man, it used to be way more corrupt, okay? Just do your history check, fact check, back check.
And less money.
You know? And less money. Tell them, you know?
No, I did. I sent him a message.
You know, I mean, look, a lot of people are in their feelings. Everybody wants bread. Everybody wants to feed their family. Everybody wants to be a legend. Everybody wants to be the big dog. Everybody wants to wear the crown. But it's not for everybody.
But Keith, everyone loves using the name Keith Thurman. I've heard Haney mention it. Everyone's like, it's so easy. Like, oh, here, I'll fight Keith. You're laughing, but it's the facts. Why do they love saying your name?
You know,
it's cool. It sounds good.
That's exactly the one thing is when you talk about Keith Thurman actually being in the ring, I've never failed. You know, I've produced some of the most exciting fights of the year as the years go on. And even if Thurman versus Barrios wasn't the most exciting fight, you know, we had our reasons at the time. It's like, it reminds me of the reason why a lot of us enjoyed Lomachenko. Some people still really enjoy Lomachenko. Some people think it's played out. But what you got to understand, what Loma did is he fought everybody. What Loma did was keep moving up in weight classes and fighting people that he couldn't reach, fighting people that he couldn't scare no more, fighting people he couldn't hurt, fighting people that could hurt him. Loma is like me. He has no fear. He'll take the black eye. He'll take it on the chin. He'll do it for his family. He'll do it for the fans. He'll do it for the sport. He'll do it for the legacy, you know? And that's the thing, man. Keith Thurman will just put on a display of punching power, boxing technique, ring gentlemanship. You never heard, oh, Keith Thurman's throwing all these rabbit punches in the back of the head. Oh, he throws these hip shots and low blows. I aim. I know where my punches go, okay? I got what's called accuracy, if you're accurate enough to see my accuracy. But at the end of the day, man, I just love the game. And once I sign that contract, I go to work with pure love and dedication. But I think a lot of people recognize that.
I'm going to tell you something about the Barrios fight. You off for a while. You came in, you showed no ring rust at all. At all. You look clean. You dominated that fight. I respect Barrios. He's a really super cool dude. It was easy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's cool.
He comes back, and he beats one of the most avoided guys in boxing, in Ugas. And now he's the interim champ. Or man, I don't know, whatever position. It's too many belts. But he couldn't do that against you. Mm-hmm. So he's another fighter that people mention they want to fight. But you becoming a champion at 54 opens up. You could fight Charlo. You could fight Crawford. Crawford wants it. If Crawford fights...
To become a champion at 54, I'd have to fight Charlo. You know? I fight this man. He keeps his belt. You know? So, we'll see. I believe that... First things first. We're testing new waters. You know? Is this move right for me? I get to not pull off 7 extra pounds, right? Which is the equivalent of 2.5 weeks minimum, 3 weeks, 2.5 to 3 weeks worth of training, of pulling, you know? So I don't have to diet as hard. I might be able to eat a little bit more carbs. Haney was talking about this in his fight with Regis Prograis, that he was happy to eat a little bit more. So I still will be training very hard, but I'll be able to eat a little more. What effect will that have on Keith Thurman's body? I'll be able to lift more. I'll be able to focus on my strength training more because I'm moving up in weight and I don't need to worry about, oh, am I gonna bulk? Is my muscle mass gonna increase to the point to where, you know, I'm increasing my muscle density, I'm increasing my overall mass. You know, there's a reason why in the sports industry we have words like bulking, you know. So I will have the capacity to not just move up, but able to bulk up and not have the negative side effect of, oh, you gotta make that cut, that super cut. Because, you know, 147, even though I've been 147 my whole life, the truth about the division is I was a freshman in high school fighting at 147. You know, I was... fighting Demetrius Andrade in the Olympic trials at 152, you know, but I knew that was just because of the amateur division was 150, 141 and 152. 147 wasn't in the picture, so I knew as a pro I would go back down to the legendary weight class with Sugar Ray Leonard, Oscar De La Hoya, Floyd Mayweather, just welterweight division. That's my division. I've established myself in that division. I'm 35 years old. If I'm going to test the waters and try to take over a division, I think now is the time to give it a try. And That's why we're stepping into this competition.
Here's my question for you and Kay. Sparring, because I haven't been with you guys in the gym. Do you normally spar bigger guys? Are you used to sparring 60, 68, 75, maybe cruiserweight, heavyweights? When you spar normally, who are you sparring?
Yeah, we're not sparring cruiserweights and heavyweights no more. We've done that in the past.
How was that?
It's fine, you know. The last good 175 pounder, but this was years ago. But the last time I had world class sparring of somebody who was truly bigger than me that I can just name drop off the top of my head was Isaac Chilembe from South Africa.
I remember him. Yep.
You know, he came to Florida.
World top 10. I remember him. Buddy McGriff trained him for a little bit.
He was working with Dan Birmingham and us for a while. And I remember he sparred a few rounds, but he needed a few more rounds. I went to go hop in with him. And I already saw some of his movement and a little bit of his habits, and I already had this little game plan, and he did something. I did a little step back one, two, bop, bop, and then he did something again. I did the same move, bop, bop, and then when we were done sparring, he was like, you a tricky little fella, you know? He's like, you got game plans, you know? And I was like, yeah, I saw something I wanted to try, and it worked out. But then he got put onto what I was doing then, and he started to make some adjustments. But, you know, it's just not an everyday thing. It's not necessary. Right. I like to spar one to two divisions of, like you said, like 160, this and that, you know. And then obviously, you know, you can have a welterweight that's out of shape and is walking around 175, 172, whatever, you know, and then you just put in some work as they continue to train, and you guys both continue to train. Eventually they'll be cutting, and it is what it is. But you know, I'm not in the ring with a 168 puncher, you know, or anything of that nature. So when it comes to sparring, you know, I'll probably have a few heavy welterweights, maybe people who are a little taller, because Tim Zoo's not supposed to be too tall. I'll get to see him tomorrow, or I'll get to see Tim Zoo's not supposed to be that tall. When I see him, I'll assess him, and we'll see. Overall, I got a 160 pounder that I'm bringing into sparring. I got a 154 pounder. And then, like I said, probably a welterweight. So it'll probably be a good mix. One thing that I like to do in training camps is I like to bring somebody in who's gonna have faster hand speed than my opponent, right? So that my eyes are trained for a speed that I'm not even gonna see. You know, I like that. If the guy's a puncher, then a good puncher is needed, right? But besides the fact that puncher, you know, what's Zoo's good punch? Is it right? Apparently it looks like a right hand. Right hand seems like it's a good punch, you know? So I'm gonna wanna bring somebody in, not just a decent puncher, but who has a solid right hand. If I respect seeing his solid right hand from the film that I've seen, you want solid right hand, you know? They say he goes good to the body. I haven't watched enough film to date so far, but I will do my homework to make sure that I pass the test come March 30th, and we'll just have to see, man. I have faith. We've done this many, many, many times. I always bring in multiple sparring partners. I always bring in an extra, so there'll probably be four guys. We'll use three in normal rotation, and then if somebody gets hurt or is not up to par for whatever reason, I just don't think that they're pushing me hard enough, I can kick them out and I can bring in the fourth guy without making phone calls like, hey, we lost somebody in sparring, now I'm stuck with two, I need that third guy.
And you wait two weeks for them to show up.
Wait 2 weeks. We don't got time for that. So we will bring enough people into the camp. I'm currently not, I don't have to spar right away. I like to work on my strength and conditioning in preparation for sparring, and then continue to evaluate my strength and conditioning as the weeks go on and I get into the ring and spar. So, you know, when it comes to the ring rust, you know, I like to say that it's because even when I'm not boxing, I'm thinking boxing, I'm meditating boxing, I'm dreaming boxing. But really, it just comes to the work that you put in. Last year, I was expecting to fight. Nothing ever came on the books. So because of that, I've just been in and out and in and out and in and out of the ring. And I don't think I'm really that out of shape. I'm actually happy with that. We get to start camp in the 60s. We're not even starting camp in the 70s. And because of the weight, I mean, we got what? This Saturday will be 8 weeks out.
Perfect.
You know,
yeah.
And I'll have less than 2 pounds to lose a week, you know? And so I'm very happy with the fact that I'm not even losing 2 pounds a week. It's going to be under that. I don't have to lose 3 pounds a week. And the stress is not going to be on my body, which hopefully should allow me to focus on certain modalities that I have not been able to utilize in the past. Because a lot of my training has been to pull fat and melt the fat off the body. I do want to be in shape. I do not want there to be a lot of wiggle and jiggle. I'm going to be doing a lot of ab work to tighten up the core, you know. So I'm just looking forward to this event. You know how boxing is. They know Keith Thurman. They respect Keith Thurman. But at the same time, they were acting like they're trying to forget about Keith Thurman. Besides some comments here and there, name drops, crazy articles, clickbait, and Carissa Shields, right? So.
Hey, they was talking of you and her sparring. Then we saw that video of some dude dropping, and she said the guy took out the pad from the gloves. How come you guys never sparred or fought? Was that not real?
She never came to me for sparring or anything. I mean.
That wasn't serious?
She can tell anybody anything. She can, you know, she can talk out of her front side and her back side. We don't really care about all that, you know. I've been in the ring with girls when I was like 9 years old, you know. I sparred, you know, it's like I said, I like certain things that are exciting.
Okay, let me ask you this, Keith. Exciting.
Talk about Carissa Shields is not exciting.
We'll talk about an exciting fight. Keith Thurman, Canelo Alvarez. If you win this fight, it's definitely a possibility. Canelo needs a good opponent. You're a huge name. Has that ever come up, you against Canelo?
What weight would that be?
68. Crawford wants to go from 47 to 68, but that may be him cashing out, maybe. It's a good fight for him.
Of course, it's a big cash out.
Yeah, and that's a big fight. AK, that's a big fight for Crawford.
Let's be real. It's a huge fight. Who beat Canelo? You know, besides the one that didn't go on books with Triple G's first fight, Bivol and Floyd, right?
Correct.
How did these men beat Canelo? Boxing. Two things. One, they weren't scared of Canelo. Two, they had good game plans. But three, they had the skills execute those game plans. Floyd being elusive the way that he was and countershotting. Bivol knowing he was the bigger guy, knowing he had the reach advantage, and keeping him on the end of his punches. Bivol was throwing the famous combo. It's called the one, the two, and the one. Bivol was not trying to have him up against the ropes, get inside, go to the body, get inside, throwing the left hooks. He wasn't putting him in trading range. I have a reach advantage. I'm gonna keep my advantage. And I think Bivol did a great job of doing that. You know, he has that robotic style where he does enough, but he doesn't do too much. It's good boxing. It's clean. It gets the job done. I mean, I was screaming at the TV, like, do more. Like, just you know, take some risk, you know? Just show him, beat the man up. If you can beat him up, right? But that's the thing about Bivol. Bivol's always been that disciplined fighter, you know? That's one thing about my opponent is that he's very poised. He's very simple in his forward approach and his backward approach. It seems, when I see people that are that simple, but they're undefeated, you know what I mean? You want to say, he's basic. He just fighting people he can beat, and he's basic. But sometimes being very solid at a basic strategy is all you need.
It's effective, yep.
You know, sometimes it's all you need. If you come well prepared, you keep your hands up, you're good at your distance, you know, it seems like he has good distance control. Now, I have some ideas. I have some things that I'm going to be working on. I believe that if what I think will occur with his in and out movement, because I see more in and out movement than I see lateral movement coming from Tim Tsu, you know, so I expect to see the same thing. That's what Tim Tsu brings into the ring. A lot of people know that I'm capable of lateral movement, so a lot of people think, well, Thurman's moving up, Tim's the bigger guy. Thurman obviously is going to bring in his athleticism and this and that. That could be a part of the strategy, you know, but we'll see. We'll see when we feel Tim's jab. We'll see when we feel Tim's right hand, his left hook, how comfortable I feel being in the pocket. Can I be in the pocket but make a miss by inches? Do I need to use a lot of lateral movement? At the same time, at what round do I use lateral movement from round one? Do I try to hold my ground? Eventually start using lateral movement after the first initial opening rounds, right? No matter what, round one, round four, round five, doesn't matter when I do start using movement, how well does he keep up? How well does he cut off the ring, move his feet? Can I trip him up the way I tripped up Mario Barrios? I saw something in Mario Barrios. I said, this is gonna be easier than my sparring partners. Fundamental mistakes on that night. Fundamental boxing mistakes. Maybe he thought I was just moving out of habit, but I don't move out of habit. I move out of methodical precision. There's a 3-minute round. I want to control as many seconds as I can in that 3-minute round. You know, yes, you got to hit the guy. Yes, you know, you got to use your defense. But just ring gentlemanship, making them miss, making them pay, you know, making them follow you, making them reach, you know, these are things I need you to show me the mistakes that you make, you know. So I see Tim Tsu's solid. He keeps his hands up, you know, but when I'm in front of him, how well does he keep his hands up? How narrow are the gaps? How big are the gaps? You know, what happens when he sees a fighter who throws punches from multiple angles? You know, my hand speed should be an advantage in this fight. You know, he seems to have some lanky arms being from a higher division. So even if the height difference isn't that big, I still expect him to have a reach advantage. So we'll see what happens with all of these things. I'm just looking forward to the fight.
The whole world is looking forward. But the last thing I want to do, I want to throw some fights to you guys. Give me guys your prediction. Mm-hmm. Canelo Benavides, who wins that one?
Oh, I just like the Mexican monster style. You know, I do believe that, you know, Benavides has taken damage in the past. He's defensively good. I actually do give him more credit than I was giving him before, but at the same time, he's gonna be there. He wants to fight, but I have to kind of favor him just because, you know, that's his division. Where Canelo's moved up, like we were talking about with Lomachenko. You know, when you're constantly taking on the best and the best and the best, you know, and that's not your division where you should be the dominant force. I mean, it's really 154 where Canelo made his name, made his fame. What, him and Floyd fought at 152, some catch weight, yeah, right? They fought at 152. So, you know, that's because he was 154. Floyd didn't want to succumb to their terms. He makes his terms, makes you pull a little bit more. You're used to pulling to get to 153.8. No, you got to be 151.8 today. Get this check, you know? So little mind games, but we all know, we've seen it. What I love the most about Canelo is that's what this fight is all about for me, is that you lose to a legend and you come back better.
Yep.
You haven't gotten to see Keith Thurman come back better because COVID. I didn't take the fights with no fans. But they finally gave me a fight. After that, I was sidelined again. And now here we are back in action. New year, new network, new division. And hopefully, in the near future, they'll be raising my hand as a new champion.
How serious were talks of you fighting Tank? Was that just online talk? Was that serious?
No, that was Leonard Ellerbe talking out of his mouth and me telling him, send a contract, you know? I love Tank, man. Tank's one of the great fighters of
today's great person generation. Too. Great person.
He's one of the people that it's just hard not to enjoy a Tank Davis fight. Like I said about a Keith Thurman fight, when skills, world-class skills, athleticism, speed, power are there on display, you know, Tank is just one of those very talented individuals who is kind of small but mighty, you know, skillful, fast, explosive, and it's exciting. It's just what boxing fans, diehard boxing fans, casual boxing fans, it's just something that the people like to see. Obviously, I'm bigger than Tank. You know, Keith Thurman's not Ryan Garcia, you know, and things of that nature. So at the end of the day, I got no problem, you know. I'm the guy who always said, I'm not afraid to let it go. If you can beat me, beat me. One time's been beaten one time. Whoop-dee-doo, who's going to beat me two times? You know, and that's what I'm here to find out. 35 years old, I see this as the second leg of my career, you know. Some people, they just fight, they do enough, and they're done. I'm happy to be here, 35 years old. The only good thing of inactivity is your man's not beat up.
But look, Keith, I know you, and I know you would love the Pacquiao rematch. Manny wants to fight. He's training. Would you welcome that fight?
Bet.
So what do you tell Manny if he's doing? Because Manny's talking about fighting maybe Mayweather, maybe fighting Tank Davis. Those are the two names I heard. Or maybe McGregor. Those are the three names. Why not add Keith Thurman?
Ask Manny, you know.
Fights Tank, what happens?
I mean, he's not. I mean, Pacquiao is a very interesting person, you know. I mean, a lot of fighters are. We're all very unique, interesting characters in the ring, outside of the ring, right? Pacquiao with his beautiful story of the Philippines, his legendary career, this and that. But, you know, we saw his last performance against Ugas. We hear this time and time again, but Manny Pacquiao is one who exudes this sentence right here in the sport, which is styles makes fights. Styles makes fights for Pacquiao, 100%. Is Pacquiao scared to get in the ring with anybody?
No.
Is he worried about getting in the ring with anybody? No. But, you know, why does he want to get back in the ring? Is it because life is so boring?
He's a senator, he's busy, but he loves it.
You know, does he? Why does he want to get back in the ring?
Big paydays? He can help more people. He's very generous with his money.
You know.
But he wants to fight the upper. He's not looking to come in and fight bad people. He wants to fight the best of the best.
He's always fought the best of the best. And he knows he has to fight the best of the best to get that payday he wants. Okay? So, you know, is it about the money? You know, is it about the money? Is it all about the money? Does he miss the sport? Does he miss the game?
I'm sure.
Does he miss you? He might miss you, bro. You know, does he miss this? The interviews, the people, the chat,
I'm sure.
the fans, and ultimately that night,
walking that out,
fight night.
Yeah, he loves. He smiles when he walks out.
You know, those bright lights. I'm very happy. I'm truly grateful for this fight against Tim Zhu.
March 30th,
pay-per-view. Amazon Prime. T T-Mobile Arena.
You know,
this is my first time for the T-Mobile Arena.
I can't
believe
it's your first time. 30-something fights in your career?
About 3 times in the Barclays. I've been in MGM Grand.
Thank you, San Antonio.
Thank you, San Antonio. You know, I mean, we've done a lot. We've done a lot, but T-Mobile is now going to be on the roster, and it's an amazing venue. I was there for the Spence Crawford fight. Wasn't happy with the fight. You know, there was a lot of hype. Wasn't really happy with the fight, but I love the arena.
Who wins the rematch?
I love the Vegas. I love what Vegas is like now that it's fully open. Even back when I fought Mario Barrios, there was still some COVID protocols. There's no more COVID protocols. And so Vegas is all the way live. And so I'm really looking forward to March 30th, full-blown conferences, weigh-ins, fans, and just electric energy.
Spence Crawford rematch, you mentioned it. You mentioned the first one. What happens?
I mean, I don't even like the rematch, you know?
Okay.
If it do happen, Crawford.
You don't like the rematch?
I mean, why? What's their rematch?
You have a rematch clause.
When rematch clause, like... Winky and Tito Trinidad had a rematch clause. There was no rematch. Who wanted to see that? Winky made Tito Trinidad look like a bobblehead on the front of your car. You know what I'm saying? Every jab. Boom, boom, boom,
boom, boom, boom. Winky's one of the most underrated fighters ever.
You know?
Great, great fighter.
And then, you know, I mean, not just because I come from his gym. I worked with him ever since I was 15 years old. But, you know, when Wink beat Sugar Shane Mosley twice, when he beat Tito Trinidad, he did that at 35, you know? And so when the way I look at this is all I need to do is get back in action, you know? Get the ball rolling. What? Give the people what they want. Let's go, champ! Let's go, champ! Give the people what they want.
That's it.
You know? I know you love me. The only reason why you hate me is because I got stale. I got sour. I left a bad taste in your mouth for hours and hours, you know? But once I get back on my feet, we get back in action, you can remember that supporting Keith One-Time Thurman has always been sweet.
Do you ever get calls from the networks, hey, we'd love you to commentate? Do you ever get that happened with Showtime or HBO or other outlets, The Zone? Amazon Prime?
We always have opportunities to commentate from time to time. They popped up. We were getting the ball rolling pre-COVID. Right after the Pacquiao fight, I did the right here at the Crypto Arena, which was a StubHub, right?
Crypto is Staples Center.
Staples Center.
Yeah.
At the Staples Center, it was Porter versus Spence.
It's a great fight.
It was like, I think a month after me and Pacquiao. And it was a great fight. I got to work that. It was a lot of fun. And I remember at that time, because of some of the part-time gigs that I was getting, I was here in downtown LA. The day after the fight, my wife and I, we went to go have some breakfast in a little spot. Some fight fans said, great fight against Pacquiao, champ. We were cheering for you. But man, we love your commentating, you know? And I was starting to be recognized in the ring, outside of the ring, and just everything that I bring to this beautiful sport of boxing with the commentating, with the insight, with the round by round, play by play, you know, it's always great, right? To be admired by the fans, you know? The best line, in my opinion, any boxer can hear from any fan is, you are my favorite fighter. You know, so when I hear that, you know, or, you know, when you're out of inactivity, we miss you, champ, supporting you, want to see you back in action, you know, with no negative connotation, just simple, hey, we're in your corner, want to see you back in action, you know. So there's a lot of just simple ways that fans interact with us athletes that just help remind us that, yeah, we're doing this for ourselves. Yes, we're doing this for our families, and we're living a dream, but we're really doing this for the fans too. You know, the fans make the sport. The athletes make the sport, but if we just fought and nobody watched, it's just a fight. You know, it's a sport because fans make sports. So to hear the fans' insight that they love my analytical side, you know, that I share this with you because that's how much of an imprint. It's little moments like that, even sometimes in my own city and town, going around, if you're on a jog, on a walk or whatever, if they're walking by, if they're driving by and they just acknowledge, shout out, hey, one time, let's go champ, you know, and it's like, I just can't wait to be back in the ring and give that person something to truly cheer for, you know, so okay. I love that about
to end this interview. Tim Zoo's watching this. What do you tell him?
Oh, Tim Zoo, you don't know what you done did, boy. You signed the wrong contract. Game over. Game over. You're going under. I know you're from down under, but you're really going under, okay? Man, Tim Zoo, I'm ready. I'm ready for you. I don't know if you're ready for me. You know, I tried telling these boys, they think they know Keith Thurman till they really get in the ring with Keith Thurman. And I just want to do that one more time. I'm going to make an example out of you, boy. You're here so that I can show the world how great I am. It's another stepping stone towards greatness.
All right. There you have it. At one time, Keith, one time Thurman on Instagram.
Yep.
Okay. Where do they follow you at?
At K Wilson.
All right. Make sure.
818.
Make sure to follow them. Make sure to tune in March 30th. Amazon Prime is the opening show. It's the first pay-per-view for PBC and Amazon Prime. And also on the card is Rolly and Pitbull. Who wins that one?
I got Rolly, man. I know Pitbull's bad. I know he fights hard. But he also gets hit. And I think they both got power. So I think they both can hurt each other. I think Pitbull can be hurt by Rolly.
All right, you heard it here first. Stay tuned. Ellie Sekpak, reporting. I'm Ellie Sekpak reporting.
ESNewsReporting.com.
I'm Ellie Sekpak reporting.